Praise the Lord. So glad you chose to worship with us tonight. Would you stand? And we get the great privilege of having Lori Barber, well, actually, Lori Infanson, sorry, I was at your wedding, and lead us in worship. This is Pastor Ron's daughter. She's filling in for our Moses, who's on spring break. Would you give her a big hand as she leads us in the presence of the Lord tonight? Amen.
Thank you. All right, let's worship together.
Amen. Before you're seated, wave at somebody and tell them hello and how are you and howdy do. You may be seated. Miss Jan, I'm going to give these to you. If you requested a certificate, and if you didn't, you'd still like one, we'll give you one gladly. You just got to give Miss Jan or Miss Deborah your name. She has your certificates already signed, sealed, and delivered for the first set in the School of Spirit. Just pick them up at the Welcome Center on your way out. She'll have them for you. And so I encourage you to do that. We had such a good time in that teaching. And, of course, part two will take place in the fall. And so I anticipate that's going to be fantastic. So tonight we're going to start a new series. Pastor John's here, and he's going to teach for the next 3 weeks on Jesus and the Passover. Of course, week three will be the Passover Seder. We'll be in the Youth Center, and we'll have the table set up. And if you've never been, at least to... One day we need to do the whole meal. Let's do that. Let's plan on that. Next year, not this year. The whole meal takes, what, 4 hours? It's supposed to. It's supposed to take about 3 hours, and because it's a process. But when you see the understanding of some of the elements of the Seder when you come on the 7th, you'll understand. It's quite the fellowship meal. And I'm going to touch a little bit on some things because I'm going to show you some things out of the triumphal entry that most people miss, that we just kind of look over it. But really, it's the start of what Christ was about to fulfill in not only the Passover, at all, but also to take away our sins. Aren't you happy about that?
Amen.
Your sins are forgiven. Your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Come on, somebody. Hallelujah. So we are in that process of getting to celebrate all the wonder of the resurrection. So check out the Facebook page. Check out the app so you know all the things that are coming up real quick. Of course, the biggest thing is for the kids, our resurrection egg hunt is this Saturday and 10 o'clock. And it's a little different. The only difference it is that we're going to start in our cars. You can turn to 90.5. And that's not going to be long. It's going to be real short. But we'll have a little message presentation, and then we'll tell you how to hunt. And this way we don't have any kind of congregating too thick, because, of course, they're still trying to keep us to separate a little bit. And so we're trying to adhere to that. And so I encourage you. And then also, don't forget the sunrise service. You have to bring a chair. If you're coming to the sunrise service and you don't want to stand the entire time, the beauty is it's only about an hour long, but at 6:30 a.m. at the park, it will be one change other than the chairs. They don't have the bleachers out there, and that's the city's rules, not ours, is it will not be on the riverside. It will be in the center of the park, and that's because of the way they do the band shell, and so we're just at the mercy of the city, and we don't want to pay $1,000 extra to have the band shell moved. So anybody say amen to that? Amen. Unless you want to give the $1,000 and you want to hook it to your truck and move it over there. Amen. All right. It's a little bit heavier than that. But anyway, we're so grateful for them allowing us to do it, as last year we couldn't because of the pandemic. But we're excited that we're back 6:30 a.m. Todd Thomas, pastor at Sebastian Christian Church, is our speaker. He's my dear friend. So I am excited about you being in church tonight. Amen.
Amen.
Who's a happy giver tonight? Amen. Let me tell you a good story, a testimony. Yes, the lady came into my office before the service, and she said, Pastor, I got to share with you. She said when they had just gone on a little kind of a spring break trip, they took Robert and Christina and her, went over to Disney with some folks here in the church, and then went on to St. Augustine. When they were over in the Orlando area, they were on Orlando iDrive there, and Christina was on one of those things, those rides there on iDrive, and Robert was watching her, and Estelita was doing what Estelita does best. You understand this, Richard, better than anybody. She had her antenna up to see who to minister to. And there was a lady who was very pregnant that she got to minister to. Not only did she lead her to Christ, but she prayed for her healing, and she prayed for her to receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit right there on iDrive. So the lady was so overcome, just emotional, and I'm telling you, this is how good God is. We are sowing into this kind of seed because this is what we as a church want to be. Amen? Amen. So five ways to give. The easiest way is the text to give. Four stations, two at the front, two at the back. Let's go ahead and stand, and we'll cover our seed with our hand, and we'll pray that God blesses it, and then we'll remain standing for worship tonight. Lord, thank you for that young lady that gave her life to Christ this past Monday over in Orlando. Thank you, Lord, for Estelita's heart to reach people with the gospel. Thank you, Lord, that she was bold. That's what we prayed, Lord. Holy Spirit boldness would overtake us. And so, Lord, that's what I'm continuing to pray. I pray, Lord, that as we plant our seed, many will be one to the kingdom as we give, not only here but around the world. To all our precious missionaries, we give you praise in Jesus' name. And everyone says, amen. Amen. Come on, let's give. Gentle whisper in the noise.
You're
lift your hands to heaven and for just 30 seconds tell him how great he is. Tell him how good he is. Tell him how awesome he is. God of power, God of wonder, God of might, the same yesterday, today, and forever. The Alpha, the Omega, meaning he's the beginning and the end. He's going to finish what he started. He didn't bring you this far to leave you. Great is our God today. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He's not concerned. He's not worried. He doesn't want us to do that either. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving. Lord, we thank you for your goodness. We thank you for your greatness. We thank you for your awesome power. We thank you for all your many blessings in our lives. So many we can't even count them, Lord. Pour out your spirit on your church tonight. Stir up the gifts within us. Expose our eyes to things we've never even considered as we study Jesus in the Passover. As the men are brought into a revelation of who you truly are in their lives through testimonies of others, Lord God. Father, tonight in the youth and the Bible explorers and all that takes place with the boys and girls and the teenagers, we're praying for softened hearts tonight, Lord. We're praying, Lord, that many will come to know Jesus Christ as Savior and Lord. They'll come to know the power of the Spirit. They'll come to know the goodness of God. We pray, we come against shame and guilt right now in the name of Jesus. We pray there's no condemnation in that room, but that they will come under conviction and they'll just surrender and the peace of God will meet them right where they are. We pray that you do that in this room and man up, Lord. That we'd simply come boldly into your throne room declaring that we don't have all the answers, but we know you do. Hallelujah. Father, we pray in faith believing for each and every one on our list, Lord God. So many, Lord, who need healing. So many who need a touch. Lori and I were talking about her dad. Lord, we just pray healing in that knee right now, Lord. Take away that pain from the therapy and all that he's going through, Lord God. We just pray, Father, that you would just strengthen him right now. And that you would cover him with your mercy and grace. And so many others, Lord, who need a touch from heaven, Lord. Some, as we prayed today at our prayer time this morning, Lord, we were talking about the spirit of infirmity. They've opened a door to the enemy somehow. I pray tonight they would shut that door so tight, they'd nail it shut. They would not allow the spirit of infirmity to come into their lives and wreak havoc, but they'd stand on the promise that by his stripes we are healed. Mind, body, soul, and spirit. They would declare who they are and whose they are. They would pick up the mantle of the identity of they are the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. And that, Father God, they would just stand in the glory of Christ and what he has done for them. And they would resist the enemy, because when they resist the enemy, he has to flee. Someone in this room, you need to, tonight, you need to close the door. You've opened something. Jim and I were talking earlier, but when we were before the service, we all need to be anchored in Jesus and we need to stop drifting. Stop drifting to the things of this world. Stop drifting to the ideas of the culture. Anchor in Jesus. Then when the storms come, then when the problems come, listen, you've got your security. You've got your sustenance. You've got what you need because he is all we need. Somebody say amen. So, Lord, do it tonight in our hearts. Anoint Pastor John as he teaches. Anoint the guys in the man-up class. Anoint Pastor Matt, Pastor Angie, and Mr. Tim. Anoint Estelita and Robert. Lord, bless Moses as he's off with Nemo tonight, Lord. Just give him a great time. God, have your way. Stir up the gifts within us, Lord, so that we leave this place different than the way we've come in, so that then we can go out into the highways and the hedges and compel them to come in. Lord, we just ask tonight special prayer for one of our missionaries. Lord, you see Amy tonight over there in Africa. Lord, I'm not at liberty to say, but Lord, we just come against the enemy who's trying to steal, kill, and destroy from some of those that are receiving Christ. And we just pray first and foremost, very difficult for a single woman to be in that kind of culture. But yet, Lord, you called her, you planted her, and you've given her great favor. So I just pray protection over her right now. I pray, Lord, that you would send those that would be her Aaron and her to hold her arms up. I pray for her young believers, Lord God, that, Father, you would keep them safe and strong, even in the face of persecution, even in the face of difficult times. And, God, that they would simply look to you, author, finisher, and perfecter of their faith. God, we just pray that you would cover her all the way across the Atlantic Ocean to the continent of Africa, and that you see her right where she's at, and you see the needs as she sent the prayer request for just a few churches that she knows will pray in faith. And so, Lord, we're one of them. We're praying in faith tonight for our sister. Do your work, Lord. So, Lord, have your way. Open our ears to hear and our hearts to receive your word. As we breathe deep of the breath of God that's been blown into our nostrils, in Jesus' name, and all God's people said, amen. Come on, give Jesus a big hand. Amen. Amen. Let's express our appreciation to Lori and the team for helping out in Moses' absence. We don't like the Latin godfather of soul being gone, but you know what? Everybody's got to be gone. Man, if you're going to man up, you're headed out. You're going to follow Gary Malone and Mr. Jim Regan over to the den, and you're going to have a great time. And the rest of you, if you didn't get your notes, make sure you wave your hand, and one of the ladies will come and bring you notes. Let's give Pastor John Small a big hand as he comes to minister the word tonight.
How's everyone doing? Did you all receive your tattoo? I have one question. Did you start it yet? You're supposed to. So while I'm talking and just saying a few words, I want you to go ahead and just start your test. You know, I feel like I taught high school for 3 years in Clearwater Largo Christian School, and it was so much fun being a teacher, to pop a quiz and to do little things that just torment the students. And so tonight I thought, my original plan was to try to ask, just kind of get some feedback from you about Passover and ask some questions and get some answers, but then I'd had to carry the mic down there. It just didn't want to work. So I want you just to go ahead and fill out those answers, and don't expect that the teaching tonight is going to answer all of those questions, because it's not, but we will go through it very quickly and just try to answer some of those questions for you. I just want you to know how much I appreciate being here tonight. It's great to have an opportunity to share with you a little bit about Passover. Let me tell you what's going to happen tonight. As I was, you know, I've taught on Passover before here, and we've talked about it. We've done a number of Seders over the years, and I didn't want to say the same things all over again. So I really believe, and it feels like I've been working on this, these three messages, actually, or two messages anyway, for weeks now. But I just felt like the Lord wanted me to encourage you tonight. So tonight is more of a devotional type of night, just going to offer you some words of encouragement. But we're going to answer the question, why Passover? And then next week, we're going to look at unleavened bread and also at the lamb. We're going to look at those two subjects and try to jump into them. Probably spend a little bit more time on the unleavened bread. And the Lord's kind of given me a theme through all of that that I want to share with you. And we'll go into that next week. And then the following week, we're going to do a Passover Seder. And if you remember, Passover Seder is simply a telling of the story. That's what it is. It's telling of the story of God's deliverance of the Jewish people, of the nation of Israel, out of Egypt. So that's what we're going to do. We're going to do it through the senses, though. We're going to partake in that Passover Seder and try out some of the things. So it's a different way of learning, but you're actually learning through your senses. So if you've never been to a Passover Seder, you really need to come. It'll be a lot of fun. Now, for those who've been to a Seder before, if you're expecting a new story, it's not. It's the same story. It hasn't changed, and we're going to tell you the same story again so that you can hear it and so that we can be reminded of the goodness of God. Can you say amen?
Amen.
So how are you doing on your test? Have you, you know, don't worry about it. Everyone's got 100 because I'm not going to grade these tests. You're all going to have 100. It's really, you know, what I wanted you to do is just see what you know about Passover. And just, there's some real simple questions there. And then there's some that may not be as simple. I don't know. You'll have to decide that and tell me afterwards, next week sometime, whether it was easy or hard, okay? But Orlando's going to help us out. We're going to put up here some of the answers. We're going to start with the first one. Passover is a feast of the Lord. And you can go to, back to the scriptures and you can look that up and see that it is a feast of the Lord. Now, the second one, from what country did God deliver the Jewish people? Yell it out if you know it.
Egypt.
All right. And God delivered Israel from what? From bondage, slavery, whatever you put down there, that's right, I'm sure. All right. And then who did God use to deliver his people? Moses. And how many plagues were there?
10.
Good job. All right. And now I want you, I'll just go over the answer on this one, but name four of the plagues that God used to deliver his people. And frogs was one, death of the firstborn. Why don't you let me walk through them and I'll just tell you what I have here. Blood, frogs, gnats, insects, livestock, boils, hail, locusts, darkness, and the death of the firstborn. So if you have something, even if you didn't word it exactly the same, that's okay. And then number 7, what stopped the final plague from entering the house? The blood of the lamb, absolutely, on the doorpost of the house. All right. And then what animal was sacrificed on Passover? This is a give me after the, say it, the lamb, right? And then God sanctified Israel for himself. Here's one that you hear pastor mention all the time. But what does it mean to be sanctified? Set apart. Very good. And then what happened in every Jewish home just before Passover began? But that's true. They did the night before. At twilight, they would kill the lamb. But even before that, they would do a little spring cleaning and clean out what? All the leaven out of the home. Very good. And then the number 11. How many cups are in a Passover Seder?
Four
cups. And what is the name? And I'm the reason I ask this question, because pastor mentions it all the time when we do communion. But he's, what is the third cup in the Passover Seder? The cup of redemption. Very good. And then what is the last food eaten at a Passover Seder? The afikoman. Very good. Now, if you don't know what the afikoman is, go home and Google it. Or come to the Passover Seder and you'll be able to, we'll talk a little bit more about that then. And what kind of bread is used during the Seder? Unleavened bread or matzah. You could say either one. Either one would be fine. And then verse 15. Every Passover Seder, they set a plate for what prophet? Elijah. And then 16. Who is the Passover lamb? Everyone got that one right, didn't you? You do now if you didn't. And then John the Baptist spoke of the Lamb of God. What did he say the Lamb would do? Take away the sins of the world. Very good. And then 18. What do we do monthly that comes right out of the Passover Seder? communion. Very good. And then 19, the Passover lamb delivered us from what? Sin, the power of sin, bondage. And then 20, what or who is the final sacrifice for our sins? Jesus. Aren't you glad? Amen. Now everyone got 100, right? That probably wasn't fair to pop a quiz on you without even teaching anything, but I thought it would be fun just to at least take a look at that. And now tonight, I really just felt, I don't know what your year has been like, but I can guess a little bit of what your last year has been like. You know, for me, November, December of 2019, I went in for shoulder surgery, and for a number of weeks, I was in misery, especially when I went to see the physical therapist, because this little gal, she couldn't have been any bigger than my honey, and she could bring tears to my eyes every time I would go in. So I spent 6 weeks finally getting over that shoulder surgery, starting to mend a little bit. COVID hits, and then we're isolated and can't go anywhere, so we're picking up these little projects around the house and doing all kinds of projects and little things that we wanted to do all along, just never got around to it. But we got around to it because there wasn't anything else to do. And one day I was picking up the vacuum cleaner, and I was just lifting it. It was in the garage, and I went like this and went to put it in the house, and I told Carol, I said, I'm in trouble. And I have a little bit of, I've had a struggle with the back, and the back went, and I couldn't even walk down the block. And we were walking 4 miles almost every day, and finally ended up in the doctor's and ended up having back surgery. That was fun. You know, just a lot of things went on. And, you know, and then, again, you're dealing with this pandemic and all of us. You know, I'm just thinking, I'm ready for the vaccine. I'm ready to be done with this thing. I'm ready to be over with it. Now, you probably didn't get that pessimistic about it all. Maybe you didn't felt different about everything, but I felt pretty, there were times I was pretty down. I will tell you something. That first week we were allowed to come back to church, it felt so good to be able to come in here and worship the Lord, you know, in with other people. It was just amazing. You remember that? So it's nice to be back. And I want to just say publicly, I think I said this once before, but I really appreciate Pastor and all that he's done. He's really worked hard. And I got to tell you something. Having been a pastor, I'm glad that I'm retired. Because that was, there were tough decisions. There were tough calls he had to make. But I think he's done a fantastic job in just serving this body. So, but he's done it through some real difficult situations and times. And he's done it, he's preached great messages and doing a great job on Wednesday night on the Holy Spirit. And just doing a great, fantastic job. And I appreciate him. So let's move into the message tonight. And why Passover? Why was there a Passover? And I began to ask myself this question and just begin to look at the scriptures and pray about it and say, Lord, what is it that you want me to say? And you may add to this list. This is not probably an all-inclusive list, but it is what I believe God gave me to share with you. First of all, if you're turning your Bibles to Genesis 15, verse 12, and one of the reasons for Passover is because God made a promise. In Genesis 15, verse 12, as the sun was setting, this is the covenant God is making with Abram. As the sun was setting, Abram fell into a deep sleep, and thick and dreadful darkness came over him. Then the Lord said to him, know for certain that for 400 years your descendants will be strangers in a country not their own, and that they will be enslaved and mistreated there. That's tough news. Verse 14, but I will punish the nation they serve as slaves, and afterward they will come out with great possession. Verse 15, you, however, will go to your ancestor in peace and be buried at a good old age. And in the fourth generation, your descendants will come back here for the sin of the Amorites has not yet reached its full measure. Verse 17, when the sun had set and darkness had fallen, a smoking fire pot with a blazing torch appeared and passed between the pieces. This is God making a covenant with Abram. And on that day, the Lord made a covenant with Abram and said, to your descendants, I give this land from the Wadi Egypt to the great river Euphrates. And I'm just going to stop at that point. God promised to give them that land. If you remember, they didn't possess the land that Abram was living in, that Isaac lived in, that Jacob lived in. They didn't possess it. The only piece of property that they actually purchased was a piece of property in Hebron, which is called the Cave of Machpelah. That's where they buried their descendants. So Abraham bought that to bury his wife Sarah there. So God made a promise to Abram about 400 years, maybe a little bit more than that, that his people, that his descendants were going to end up in Egypt. They were going to end up enslaved. They were going to be mistreated. But God said to him, he said, but I'm going to punish that nation. And when you leave, you're going to leave with great possession. Now, I want to read from Exodus chapter 3, verse 22. I don't think I have that on an overhead, but that's okay. Every woman is to ask, this is the Lord speaking to Moses. He said, every woman is to ask her neighbor and any woman living in the house for articles of silver and gold and for clothing, which you will put on your sons and your daughters, and so you will plunder the Egyptians. Then we see you don't need to turn there, but in Exodus chapter 12, verse 36, you actually see the fulfillment of that happening. The Israelites plundered Egypt. They took the gold and the silver and the clothing and all the finest things that were there in Egypt, and they took that with them as they began their journey to the land of milk and honey. Now, they were also promised the land of Canaan. I'm not going to go into that now because you all know that they didn't go into the land of Canaan until the time of Joshua, when Joshua walked in and they took control of the land of Canaan. But through all of this, what do you see? You see the faithfulness of God to keep his promises. God's going to keep his promises. If he makes a promise, you can count on him. Do you believe that? Yes. Numbers 23:19 says, God's not a man that he should lie, or the son of man that he should change his mind. Aren't you glad that when God says it, that settles it? You can count on him. You can trust him. You can depend on him. In Psalms 119, verses 89 and 90, forever, O Lord, your word is firmly fixed in the heavens. Your faithfulness endures to all generation. You have established the earth, and it stands fast. So, my paraphrase, you can count on the Lord. You can depend on him. You can trust him. If he makes a promise, is he going to keep it? He's going to keep it. How many know that there's a lot of promises in the Word of God? How many know that God is in the business of keeping his promises? We can trust him. We can depend upon him. Just as God made a promise to Abraham, told him, yes, they're going to go down and they're going to be in bondage for 400 years, but I'm going to bring them out. I'm going to bring them out with great possession, and I'm going to bring them back to this land that you're living in right now. and they're going to possess this land. God kept his word. It took 400 years, over 400 years, but God kept his word. You know, Christians today are a little bit like we go to McDonald's and we're used to getting it quick. Am I right? Now, God doesn't, the promises of God don't always happen just like that. We can trust him. We can depend on him. But sometimes they take a little time. But God will always come through. You know, there's a promise that the Lord made. One day he's coming back again. Now, it's been 2,000 years, but guess what? He's still coming back. You can still count on the fact that he is coming back, because God is not a man that he should lie. He is truthful in what he says. The second reason comes right out of Exodus chapter 3, verse 7. And the Lord said, I have indeed seen the misery of my people in Egypt. I have heard them crying out because of their slave drivers. I am concerned about their suffering. So I have come down to rescue them from the hand of the Egyptians and to bring them up out of the land into a good and spacious land, a land flowing with milk and honey, the home of the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Amorites, Perizzites, and Hivites, and the Jebusites, and a lot of ites. But the point was that God saw their misery. You know, God has seen what you've been going through over the last, 12 months for sure, but even longer, possibly. God knows what you're going through right now. God sees if there's difficulties in your life. He sees your misery. He sees your hurting. In Psalms 10, verse 14, but you, God, see the trouble of the afflicted. Now, maybe you felt like over the last year or so you've been afflicted. When my back went out, I felt afflicted. I felt it. But I am so thankful that God was right there, that he saw my misery. He saw what I was going through, and he cared about what I was going through. I'm going to read on in that verse. You consider their grief and take it in hand. The victim commits themselves to you. You are the helper of the fatherless. See, God knows when you're in the midst of the fire. He sees your misery. God's right there with you. The Bible says he's a friend who sticks closer than a brother. He'll never leave you or forsake you. They're promises of God. Do you believe it's true? When my back went out, where are you, Lord? But he was right there. He saw. He knew what was going on. And I'm thankful for God, for his presence. Being on lockdown for almost a year, God sees that. He knows what you're going through. I know some of you were nervous about getting out and doing things and going. I'm thankful. I've got the vaccine, at least number one. Number two is coming next Wednesday. I'll be glad to get that, and hopefully we can get out of the mask and get out of everything else and get past all of this craziness. But God sees. God knows what's going on. And he hadn't forgotten us. He cares about us. He's concerned about you and what you're going through. And maybe what you're going through right now has nothing to do with COVID or anything else. Maybe there's issues in your family. Maybe there's struggles and there's battles that you're going through. You know, over the last year, we've had a few issues in our family. Few issues that I'm not going to talk about now, but a few issues that were a little, they shook us a little bit. But God sees. God sees, and he knows what we're going through, and I'm thankful he showed up and he's there. Every minute of the day, he's a friend who sticks closer than a brother. See, I believe God wants to remind us that even when you're going through difficult times, even when you feel afflicted, even when you're in misery, God wants to remind you that he's right there with you. He's there to rescue you And I wrote here in my notes, and to lead you out. But I added this, or to lead you through. Sometimes we want the escape, and God wants us to go through whatever it is we might be facing. He wants us to go through. It doesn't mean we're going to stay there. We're going to go through. We're going to come out the other side. It's like going into a tunnel. My mom used to go through. How many have been through the Baltimore Tunnel? Anybody been through the Baltimore Tunnel? My mom used to hate that tunnel. She would take the bypass around it every time because she always felt like it was closing in on her. But I like the idea of going through the tunnel. Because when you go through the tunnel, there's a point in which you start to see daylight. And all of a sudden, you're out, and hopefully the sun's shining. And you move out into the wide open spaces again. Thank God. And that's what God does. Sometimes we go through some difficulties. We go through some battles in our life. We're afflicted. We may experience some misery in our life, whatever that might be. There's the end of the tunnel, and there's daylight on the other side, and God will see you through. Hallelujah. Another reason for Passover is God heard their cry. In verse 9 of Exodus chapter 3, "And now the cry of the Israelites has reached me, and I have seen the way of the Egyptians, the way the Egyptians are oppressing them. So now, go. I am sending you to Pharaoh to bring my people, the Israelite, out." God heard their cry. God heard their cry. And, you know, sometimes when we're afflicted, when we're going through difficulties, you know what it causes us to do? Cry out to the Lord. I'll share a story with you. It's a story about the shoulder surgery. I couldn't sleep in bed. I slept in a recliner, but the handle was on this side. It was this shoulder. So I couldn't get to the lever. And so we bought a little storage container, and I propped my feet up on the container and put a pillow on top of the container and threw the blanket over me and slept in my recliner. But that very first night, they had given me a block. So I didn't feel anything with a block. And they said it should last 24 to 36 hours. It lasted about 12. And that night, I was awake, and I didn't mean to do this, but I guess I woke my honey up. Because I was walking in the living room, and I was crying in my misery, crying out, "Oh, God, oh, God." I walked that floor quite a bit that night. But guess what? God brought me through. God brought me through. God saw me. You know, Psalm 61, verse 1, "Hear my cry, O God. Attend unto my prayer. From the ends of the earth will I cry unto thee. When my heart is overwhelmed, lead me to the rock that is higher than I." Verse 3, "For thou hast been a shelter for me and a strong tower for the enemy." You remember that as a chorus a few years ago? How many wave at me if you remember it? It was a beautiful, beautiful chorus. "Hear my cry, O God, attend unto my prayer. From the ends of the earth will I cry unto thee. Oh, when my heart is overwhelmed, lead me to the rock that is higher than I, that is higher than I." You remember that one? What a beautiful chorus. But lead us to the rock. When we cry out to God, that's He's leading us to Himself. He's saying, "Here I am. I'm right here. I hear what you're going through." This passage I want to read from Psalms 121 is really a scripture that's written for Israel, but easily applied to all of us. In verse 1, it says, "I lift up my eyes to the mountains. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. He will not let your foot slip." Thank God. He who watches over you will not slumber. He's not going to take a nap in the afternoon. I kind of like my nap in the afternoon, but God's never going to take a nap in the afternoon on you. You don't have to worry. When you cry out to him, he's going to hear you. Indeed, he who watches over Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord watches over you. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The sun will not harm you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will keep you from all harm. He will watch over your life. The Lord will watch over your coming and your going, both now and forevermore. I'm here to say tonight that God sees your misery and he hears your cry and he will respond to you because he's a faithful God. When he makes a promise, he's going to keep his word. Can you say amen?
Amen.
The fourth one is that God was calling Israel in Exodus 19. Verse 3, Moses went up to God, and the Lord called to him from the mountain and said, "This is what you are to say to the descendants of Jacob, and what you are to tell the people of Israel. You yourselves have seen what I did in Egypt, and how I carried you on eagle's wings and brought you to myself." Now, I highlighted that in my notes here. "I brought you to myself." Verse 5. "And if you obey me fully and keep my covenant, then out of all the nations you will be my treasured possession. Although the whole earth is mine, you will be for me a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. These are the words you are to speak to the Israelites." So God was calling the nation of Israel into a personal relationship with him. And then once they moved into that relationship, he was saying, "You are my treasured possession. You're a kingdom of priests." And the kingdom of priests, priests represent people to God. And I believe that God was calling Israel to represent him to the world. And he was calling them to be a holy nation. Others will see when we're living a holy life, and it will change their hearts and their lives. Others are watching you. How many know that others are watching you? In Deuteronomy 7, verse 6, "For you are a people holy to the Lord your God. The Lord your God has chosen you out of all the peoples on the face of the earth to be his people, his treasured possession." But why? Why would he choose Israel to be holy? Why were they chosen? Why were they a treasured possession? Deuteronomy 7, verse 7. "And the Lord did not set his affection on you or choose you because you were more numerous than other peoples, for you were the fewest of all peoples." Verse 8. "But it was because the Lord loved you and kept the oath he swore to your ancestors, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob." There's the faithfulness of God in keeping his promises. "That he brought you out with a mighty hand and redeemed you from the land of slavery, from the power of Pharaoh, king of Egypt. Know therefore that the Lord your God is God. He is faithful God, keeping his covenant of love for 1,000 generations to those who love him and keep his commandments." Aren't you glad that God is faithful in keeping his promises? So when you read that passage, why did God choose Israel? First of all, they didn't earn it. It's not because they were special. It's not because they were better. But he chose them because he chose them and because he made a promise to Abraham. He made a promise and he was simply keeping his promise. God is always faithful in keeping his promises. When he makes them, you can count on them. Israel didn't earn the right to be that treasured possession. Israel didn't earn the right to be that holy nation. They didn't earn the right to be the chosen people. But God made a promise and he was keeping it, even though they weren't really good enough. Guess what? We didn't earn it either. We didn't do anything to get where we are today. So all we did is say, yes, Lord, you've already paid the price, and we received him into our life. They were called, Israel was called to be a blessing to the nations. You know the passage well because you've heard it many times in Genesis 12, but he says, I'm going to make you into a great nation. I'm going to bless you, and I'm going to make your name great, and you'll be a blessing. And I will bless those who bless you, and whoever curses you, I will curse. And then all the peoples on the earth will be blessed through you. I could talk about the blessing of Israel, but that's not really ultimately my goal here tonight. But I do want to mention the ultimate blessing Israel gave to us was the Lamb of God, Jesus, the Passover Lamb. That was the ultimate blessing that Israel gave to the world. They gave us the Lamb to take away the sins of the world. Hallelujah. You know, Israel was called to represent him to the world. And I was thinking about a passage of Scripture. Remember the story of Solomon and the Queen of Sheba? Do you remember that story out of 2 Chronicles chapter 9? But listen to what the Queen of Sheba said. She said to the king, "The report I heard in my own country about your achievements and your wisdom is true. But I did not believe what they said until I came and I saw with my own eyes. Indeed, not even half of the greatness of your wisdom was told me. You have far exceeded the report I heard. How happy your people must be. How happy your officials who continually stand before you and hear your wisdom." Now listen to verse 8. "Praise be to the Lord your God, who has delighted in you and placed you on his throne as king to rule for the Lord your God, because of the love of your God for Israel and his desire to uphold them forever. He has made you king over them to maintain justice, justice and righteousness." So what am I saying? They were to be a kingdom of priests. They were to represent the Lord wherever they went. The Queen of Sheba heard about it and said, "I've got to go and see with my own eyes what's going on." And then she goes and she meets Solomon and she recognizes his wisdom and all the blessings of God there. And then she says, "Praise be to the Lord your God." What a wonderful statement. And that's what our lives are to do, to impact this world where others look at you and say, "Praise the Lord that you were there at that particular moment in time. Praise God for representing the Lord. Praise God for praying for me." We had our neighbors just call us. Our neighbor's going through a physical battle, and we've been praying with them, and they're not necessarily churchgoers. They came to church with us one time when we had the drama over here in the other building, and I think they were a little startled by it all, but they said, "Thank you for praying for us. Thank you," because we're always reminding them, "We're praying for you. We're praying for you." And they call us now. They said, "Will you pray for us?" And yes, we're going to pray for you. And what an opportunity. Now we're just praying the Lord will give us the right opportunity to share with them the gospel so that they'll turn their hearts to him. But God is calling us to be a people that represent him. He's calling whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. He's called us to be a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a special possession, that we might declare the praises of him who called us out of darkness into this wonderful light. So the calling that God placed on Israel, he's placing on us as well. to be a holy nation, to be a special possession, to declare his praises and to represent him. What's the scripture say? I really believe this is a theme verse in the scripture. Matthew 5:16. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven. God is calling us to represent him to a lost and dying world. Calling us to represent him so that they can see Jesus. So when you're in Walmart and you're there and somebody needs prayer, pray for them. Doesn't matter if they're Christian or not. Pray for them. The Lord opens up an opportunity to share the gospel. Share the gospel. Let your light shine. Let the light of Christ shine through your lives. The last area. God uses Passover to show us the Lamb of God. I'm just going to keep this brief because we're going to talk a lot about this in the next few weeks. But what did John the Baptist say when he saw Jesus? He said, "Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world." When Paul was writing to the believers at Corinth, not the whole verse, I'm just going to pick part of the verse out, but he writes to them and he said that Christ, the Passover lamb, has been sacrificed. Everything about the feast, Passover, even unleavened bread, all point to Jesus, the Messiah. The reason we need to know about Passover is because Jesus is that Passover lamb. So why Passover? Let me just quickly go back over the main points. God is showing us that he's faithful in keeping his promises. God sees, he saw the misery of Israel, and he sees when you're going through difficulties and struggles, when you're afflicted, when you're in a battle, God sees you. And God hears your cry when you cry out to him. When you cry out to him, he leads us to Jesus, who will help us, who will strengthen us, who will encourage us, who will bring us through or lift us out. One way or the other, we're going to get through that situation. And God, just like God was calling Israel to himself, he's calling us to himself. You say, "I already know Jesus." Well, I think he's calling us into a deeper walk with him. He's calling us closer and closer and closer to him all the time. Then God uses Passover to point to the Lamb of God. Lead me to the rock that's higher than I. Lead me to Jesus. I need Jesus. I need him. I can't wait till we get through this tunnel completely with COVID. I'm ready. I'm ready to get through it. I'm ready to go back on a cruise again. We've had a cruise booked twice and it's been canceled both times. Ready to go on a cruise again. I'm ready to get back on life again. We started life again and we go to the restaurants. We're not afraid to go to the restaurants. We do that. We're careful. We are careful. We've reached that category, 69. I'm old enough to be careful. I'm not foolish, but I'm not living in fear. I have been down a few times. I will tell you. I'll be honest with you. I've been down. I don't know if you think that's a terrible thing to say or not, but it's the truth, so I'm not going to lie to you. I've been down a little bit over the last year and a half, but I'm so thankful. God saw me right where it was at. He heard my cry. He hears your cry. And he leads you to the Lamb of God. The one who walks alongside of us, who's a friend, who sticks closer than a brother. The one who will never leave us, never forsake us. But he's right there with me. Even when I don't feel like he's there, he's there. You know the little poem of footprints. I'm sure you like me, my mind goes right there. Well, Lord, there was only one set of footprints. It's because at that point I was carrying you.
whatever it takes, the Lord is there. If he has to carry you, throw you over his neck like he did the lost sheep, whatever it takes, he's going to get you through. You're not alone. You are victorious in him. So whatever you're going through tonight, if you, I'm sure the Lord didn't have me put this on paper for nothing. Somebody here tonight is going through some things. I want you to know that God sees you right where you are. Now, take a moment and just cry out to him. You present that need before him. Father, across this place tonight, there are needs, there are concerns, there are some folks that may be afflicted, maybe going through some struggles and some battles. But Lord, I believe that you're here. As they cry out to you, I believe is that Scripture says, as we cry unto you, you will lead us to the rock that is higher than I am. Lord, lead them right now as they present that need and that concern, that affliction. If they're in need of healing, Lord, we believe that you're the healer. If there's family issues, Lord, we believe that you're going to step into the middle of that situation. Lord, whatever that need might be, we thank you for who you are and all that you're doing in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for meeting needs tonight. If you're here tonight and you don't know Jesus as your Savior, I just want to pause for a second. You want to know him, just wave at me and let me know. Anyone at all, you don't know Jesus as your Savior. Usually Wednesday nights, most people that come are believers. I'm trusting we all know Jesus. And you know the rock that is higher than you are. And you can trust him. Father, tonight I thank you for each one that's here. And I thank you, Lord, that you've begun a work in each of our hearts and each of our lives. It's been a difficult year, but Lord, you've seen. You know what we've gone through. And Lord, I'm so thankful that you've heard a cry. And we're coming through. And we're expecting great things from you in our lives. Draw us closer to you each and every day. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, God bless you. You have a wonderful evening.